mots dans la langue de Molière avant de massacrer celle de Shakespeare. Merci aux organisateurs, qui sont français donc. Et je vais bien sûr passer à l'anglais, mais je voudrais dire combien je suis heureux d'ouvrir ce colloque à l'IHES. So I'm very pleased to open this workshop in IHES. It's a pleasure to be here, and it's a pleasure to talk about analysis here. So the work I'm going to talk about is issued from a long joint work in collaboration with Enno Lenzmann, Oana, Pocovnicu, and Pierre, Raphael. And it's likely that some of you already listened to one of us talking about it in the last few years, during the last few words. It turns out that we changed a little bit the presentation now. We made the paper shorter. But I would like to apologize to those of you who listened to me recently, particularly to Atem, because he listened to twice to this talk. But this one is slightly different. I will focus on some different features I never discussed so far. So the main idea is to talk about some very simple one-dimensional equation, which is called the half-wave equation. So we are working on R. There are some versions on the circle, but I will not discuss it here. And we are introducing the classical notation d equals 1 over I d dx. And so my multiplier is... my main multiplier in this story is mod d, which corresponds in the Fourier representation as multiplication by absolute value of xi. Okay. So the half-wave equation is the following one-dimensional model. So u is a complex valued function of variable t and x, and have the following equation, I dtu minus mod du plus mod u square u equals 0. So first of all, you should observe that this is a wave equation, in the sense that if you look at the characteristics or the dispersion relation, this is mod xi. So you have two velocities, group velocities, which are plus or minus 1. Okay, so at least for the linear part, this is really the wave equation. And in fact, it's a half-wave equation, because your Dalabertian, your classical Dalabertian, is just I dt minus mod d, I dt plus mod d. Okay, so this is the reason of half-wave. Now this one is first with the nonlinearity, which is cubic, which is certainly in this context the most natural nonlinearity you could have. And secondly, you have here a plus sign, which means, we will see this a little bit later on, very shortly, this plus sign means we are in the focusing case. So focusing case, and if you know about the work about nonlinear wave equation particularly, and you know that focusing case is known to admit more nonlinear objects in the language of Franck, for instance. And we will use this very much, even if the defocusing case could be very interesting too, okay, but probably more complicated for what we are going to do. Okay, so why looking at this equation? In fact, the main motivation about this equation is to look at what we call sometimes wave turbulence But wave turbulence is a very complicated and not that well identified area. So I prefer to talk about growth of Sobolev norms, which is for sure a strict subset of wave turbulence, in the sense that it measures, in some sense, the appearance of small scales. So why looking at this equation in this context? Well, you can, for instance, look at papers, which a series of papers by Maida, McLaughlin, and Tabak, but also starting in the late 90s, and also Zakharov, Diaz, Guyenne, well, many other people, I'm sorry, around 2000, which tried to give some general description of one-dimensional wave turbulence. And they studied that kind of equation here with an alpha. Okay? And they noticed that for alpha bigger than 1, for alpha equals 2, you have the nonlinear Schrödinger equation, cubic nonlinear Schrödinger equation, and this equation is known to be integrable with plenty of very strong conservation laws, and it's a classical result, coming back to Zakharov and Shabbat, that in fact all the Sobolev norms are controlled by the conservation laws. If you now if you lower the power alpha, you will see that, okay, if you make some kind of resonant analysis, I will not go into details here, but the resonance analysis will tell you that there are no non-trivial resonant terms if alpha is bigger than 1. And you can find them if alpha is smaller than 1 for some convexity reasons. Now, for alpha equals 1, you are precisely in the first case where you have many resonant terms. And in fact, for alpha equals 1, you have a big resonance set, make the appearance of wave turbulence favorable. I mean, certainly the most favorable situation for the appearance of wave turbulence. Okay, so this is one of the reasons. There is another one. And the other reason why we look at this equation is that this equation, in some regime, is very close to another integrable equation, which is called the Seger equation that I studied with Sandrine Grelier during the last 5 or 6 years now, and in this context was studied in her PhD thesis by Oana Pocovnicu. Okay. So the fact that we are close to an integrable system will help us to study more closely the equation and the solution, in particular, more closely the regime of modulation of traveling waves. So in fact, what we are going to do is to study small mass solitons for this equation. So, and as a second part, which is the main one, their interaction. Okay. And we will see that this interaction will lead to some growth of Sobolev norm. So let me be a little more specific by reminding you about the Cauchy theory. So maybe the Cauchy theory is now quite classical for this equation. It was completely understood by Krieger, Lenzmann, and Raphael in a nice paper in 2013. And the point is that you have essentially, so first of all, conservation laws, which will help you. We have three conservation laws. The first one is, of course, the energy, corresponding to the Hamiltonian of this Hamiltonian system. So this is a half of mod d uu. So this is the L2 inner product, the real part of the L2 inner product, but the same here, minus 1/4 the L4 norm to the 4. You have the momentum p, which is duu. And finally, you have the mass, which is u in L2 square. Okay. So these three guys are conserved. And using the first one and the second one, exactly as we did, as was done by Michael van Steen around the 80s, you can prove first a global existence theorem in HS for S at least a half, which corresponds to the energy space here. Global existence for initial data, or for mass, if you prefer, smaller than the mass of some ground state, Q0. So Q0 is a ground state solution of this equation, mod dQ0 plus Q0 equals Q0 squared Q0. So this is really the same idea as the work by Weinstein for L2 critical NLS. Observe that this is also L2 critical, by the way. If you look at a solution U of Tx and you change the scale that way, lambda to the 1 half U of lambda t lambda x, you get still a solution. So and this ground state solution was proved to be unique in a nice paper by Frank and Lenzmann, up to, of course, translation, etc. And so that this is the first part. The second part is about existence of critical mass blow-up solution. So there exists, in fact, minimal mass blow-up solution. Which is obtained by some kind of modulation of this Q0 plus something small. And this is, of course, very close to the study that was done by Frank and his collaborators, except that the theorem by Frank about characterization of such minimal mass blow-up solution is not available yet. Okay? It's an open question. But at least you can find examples. Okay, and finally, the third result, which appears in this beautiful paper by Krieger, Lenzmann, and Raphael, is that there exists, in fact, and this is very different from nonlinear Schrödinger, there exists small mass solitons. And in fact, for every epsilon small, you can find a soliton of mass epsilon. Okay, so for every epsilon positive, there exists a mass, a soliton of mass epsilon. So in particular, you don't have any kind of scattering for small mass, scattering phenomenon. This is, of course, very much connected to the fact that your equation is not dispersive. Because the evolution of the group velocity, let me remind you what I told in the very beginning, the group velocity is plus or minus 1. So the group velocity is essentially not moving, except at a point at t equals 0, where it has a jump. But otherwise, you don't have any kind of it's completely degenerate. Okay. So now let me tell you a little bit more about these small mass solitons. And this will be the second part of my talk. So the idea for Q0, remember, Q0 is obtained by minimizing the following functional, which is here mod duu, ul2 square, divided by UL44. So this is a classical Gagliardo-Nirenberg functional. So you minimize it. and you get objects which are essentially Q0 up to translation and multiplication and deletions and multiplication by phase factor. Now, it turns out that here you can modify a little bit this functional without making it, with keeping it equivalent to J0 by introducing for every beta between minus 1 and 1, the functional g beta of u equals minus d minus beta d uu ul2 square divided by u to the fourth. So I'm given a beta between minus 1 and 1, strictly. And then, of course, the term which change here is still equivalent to mod d uu given beta. Okay? So I can as well minimize j beta on the energy space, on H half. Okay? So what happens if I minimize j beta on H half? I can just argue a little bit with the concentration compactness, and I can find minimizers. There exist minimizers. If you write the Euler-Lagrange equation of these minimizers, you will find, after rescaling, the following expression. So let me divide it by y minus beta. I can always do it, but this is better for me for what I'm going to say. I'm sorry. It's plus q beta equals mod q beta square q beta. Okay. So this is the Euler-Lagrange equation. And this tells you that if you look at the function u beta of tx, which is e to the it q beta of x minus beta t divided by 1 minus beta, this function is a traveling wave solution, is a solution to your equation. Okay. Of course, I could avoid this 1 minus beta here and could avoid this. That would be absolutely the same. Why did I put it here? Just because, in fact, so this is a traveling wave solution with a velocity, speed, which is beta. And beta, remember, is smaller than 1, which is perfectly in accordance with relativity principles. Okay, Michalis? So because the speed of light here is 1. Okay. But now I'm, in fact, interested in continuing with the metaphor with relativity. I'm interested in the photonic limit. So what happens when beta goes to 1? Because when beta goes to 1, well, in fact, you can prove that when beta goes to 1, your q beta itself is bounded, and we will see it's bounded in every Sobolev norm. So it's a very nice function, and so that the mass of u beta, the mass of u beta is 1 minus beta times O of 1, which is the mass of q beta. And so, just by change of variable. And so as beta goes to 1, the mass goes to 0. Okay? If I can prove that q beta stays bounded in HS. So why is q beta bounded in HS? Because as beta goes to 1, you will see exactly what happens in this equation. So either, I mean, of course, you have this awful operator, mod d minus beta d, what. What is this operator? In fact, you can see it exactly if you project, if you use the Segre projector, which are the projectors on the positive or negative xi variables. Okay? So if you project, for instance, on xi positive, mod d is d. But then this term is just d. 1 minus d minus beta d divided by 1 minus beta. It's just d. So you get d q beta plus q beta plus equals pi plus of q beta square q beta. Okay? Now, if you project on xi negative, you will get a very different equation, which is 1 plus beta divided by 1 minus beta mod d q beta minus plus q beta minus pi minus of q beta squared q beta. So, in fact, you can prove using this that, of course, the q beta minus is penalized as beta goes to 1, and with it's essentially it will go to 0, while the q beta plus will have a limit. And the limit, and this is, in fact, the first result that we proved, is that as beta goes to 1 and up to a subsequence, we have that if I take such a minimizer solution of this Euler-Lagrange equation, I get, and up to some translation, that this goes to some e to the I gamma, some function q plus of x, and q plus of x is a solution to this equation, which is precisely the equation I get by passing to the limit in the projected, the first projected equation. Okay? So this q plus will be supported in the Fourier space in xi positive, of course. Okay. So it turns out that, okay, you could say, well, and so what? What do you know about this equation? And it turns out that we know everything. Because Oana did the job during her thesis, and Oana Pocovnicu, in her thesis, and it's a very nice paper in 2013, she proved that q plus is precisely, again, up to some translations, 1 over x plus I over 2, explicitly. It's 1 over x plus I over 2. Okay, so you can multiply it, of course, by some phase factor, by some translation. But you can, in fact, characterize all the solutions, not only the minimizing, all the solutions to this equation in H half, let's say, they are this. Okay, so it's a very nice theorem. And it's extremely useful, of course. Because even if we don't know about q beta itself, we know its limit as beta goes to 1 after rescaling. Okay, so what I would like to say, moreover, is that, in fact, so this is the first part of proposition 1. The second part of proposition 1 tells you that, well, if you impose, moreover, that q beta is orthogonal to I q plus and to dx q plus, so what are these guys? These guys, the span of iq plus and dxq plus on the real, as a real vector space, is precisely the kernel of the linearized operator along q plus for the equation I wrote for q plus. This linearized operator plays a very important role in all that kind of construction of modulation theory, and we know how to identify the kernel here. Okay? So if you demand that q beta is orthogonal to these guys, essentially, for beta close to 1, you have characterized q beta. Then q beta is characterized q beta tends to q plus, in that case, exactly, as beta tends to 1, for beta between beta star and 1, say. And in fact, the map beta is q beta is a smooth map. Is smooth map on the interval beta star 1, valued in h infinity. And in fact, we know more about this q beta. We know more about this q beta. Let me write it down for you. Moreover, q beta has an expansion for big x and small beta so q beta first looks a little bit like q plus as x goes to infinity 1 over x times some modulation factor which is very interesting which is f of minus 1 minus beta divided by 1 plus beta x plus capital O of log x divided by x cube. And this function f is a special function. F of tau is the integral from 0 to infinity of alpha e to the minus alpha divided by alpha minus I tau d alpha, which, well, essentially, if tau equals 0, or if tau is small, close to 0, tends to 1. And if tau goes to infinity, it is like I over tau. Okay. So what does that mean? It means that you will see some kind of multiscale competition. A competition between the big X and the inverse of the small parameter 1 minus beta. Okay? And so, for instance, this will be like 1 over x is if 1 minus beta x smaller than 1. But on the other hand, it will be I divided by 1 minus beta x squared if 1 minus beta mod x bigger than 1. Okay? And so, and of course, you will have some intermediate regime, some turning point regime, around x equals 1 over 1 minus beta. Okay? So this is very important, of course, in the calculation we are going to do. Okay, so this is the first result. And now what we are going to do is to study the two-soliton interaction. So for this two-soliton interaction, I chose to, in fact, offer you some comparative study. So between the Seger equation, which is the equation, I will write it down, but this is the equation of which q plus is a traveling wave versus the half wave. Yeah?
Excuse me, stupid question, maybe you said it already. Is the q beta unique?
Yes. If you demand this orthogonality conditions, okay, and q beta solution of the equation, I wrote the Euler-Lagrange equation, then it's unique for beta close enough to 1. This is the implicit function theorem, essentially. Okay. Of course, you could change a little bit these conditions, but it should be close to that in order to apply the implicit function theorem. And then you know that q beta tends to q plus. It's a smooth branch of traveling waves. And again, these traveling waves have small mass, and the mass is going to 0 as beta tends to 1. Okay? Okay, so now, so what is the Seger equation? And what is the half wave? So half wave, we wrote it down already. Let me write it again for you. For Seger, let me write it like this, I dt u plus minus du plus pi plus u plus square u plus equals 0. So I put a plus just to remind you that u plus has a Fourier transform supported in xi non-negative. Okay? So what kind of information can I discuss? The first kind of information are conservation laws. So again, for the half wave, I already told you we have three main conservation law: energy, momentum, and mass. Here, we also have energy, but in fact, in that case, the energy is essentially the L4 norm to the 4, maybe 1/4, but whatever, the momentum and the mass, plus something else. In fact, you have something very big else, because this equation, as I told you, is integrable. But now, if I'm interested in two-soliton interaction, in fact, I need just one more to have a closed system of conservation laws in involution in order to get a Hamiltonian system which is integrable in the sense of Liouville. I will see it. So these are conservation. So one more here. Second point, what is the two soliton interaction here? So what is the two soliton solution? Well, here the two soliton solution is something extremely simple. It's a solution like this, sum from j equals 1 to 2 of q plus, oh sorry, forgot the scaling factor. Let me write it down. Alpha j of t, q plus of x minus xj of t divided by kappa j of t. And what is really quite exceptional in such a situation is that we have exact solution of that kind. No remainder term. So if you start from datum which is of that kind, at t equals 0, where alpha j's are complex numbers, kappa j's are positive numbers, and xj's are real numbers, then you keep such a solution for all time. This is, of course, an expression of this integrability property. Okay? And the fact that you have this four conservation law will allow you to solve completely, in a complete explicit way, the ODE system of these on these eight real parameters. Here you have two real parameters, one and one, 4 times 2 equals 8. So you have 8 real parameters, so it's a symplectic manifold of dimension 8, if you like, and you have four conservation laws in involution, so you have really uvial integrability, and you can solve it explicitly.
So the solitons don't interact at all?
They interact, but in such a way that they don't produce something new in the remainder term, but they interact because you will see that the ODE will have some special behavior for a long time. So what's the special behavior of the ODE?
It's a system of ODEs.
It's a system of ODEs. Okay? And that you can solve. You don't need any kind of elliptic function of whatever. Okay? You can solve it in an algebraic way. It's completely explicit. Okay? That was done by Oana too. And then what happens as t goes to infinity under some kind of resonant condition, so you have a submanifold of this symplectic manifold of dimension 8, you have a submanifold of dimension 2, in fact, of codimension 2, which is given by this condition, alpha 1 divided by x1 minus x2 minus I kappa 1 plus kappa 2 over 2 equals upper 2 divided by x1 minus f2 plus I kappa 1 plus kappa 2 over 2. So this is a manifold which is invariant by the ODE system that I don't write, but you can imagine there is one. And on this submanifold, you know that the minimum of these factors kappa j of t on g equals 1 and 2 goes to 0 like 1 over t squared as t goes to infinity. What does that mean? Well, it means that if as t goes to infinity, imagine, for instance, this is the second one, kappa 2, then this bubble will be extremely concentrated. And if you compute a high Sobolev norm, so a high Sobolev norm here, it means HS for S bigger than a half, so typically H1, for instance, the H1 norm will be like T square. The H1 norm square will be like T square. Okay, you can compute this. So the mechanism of this is quite interesting here. The mechanism is that you have these two guys, x1 and x2, and this is the first soliton as t goes to infinity will be the fastest, and this will be the most concentrated. Okay? You have that kind of thing. And then if you go back and go to the past, as t goes to minus infinity, then they will exchange. They will exchange their width in some sense, and then this one will be the most concentrated and will go faster to minus infinity.
Stay always apart.
Yes, there are several regimes, but the one I'm going to describe is this one. And at some point, when their distance is minimal, their widths are equal. Okay,
it's
perfectly symmetric. Okay. Now, what happens for half wave? So for half-wave, you just have three conservation laws. And the theorem I'm going to state more precisely in 1 minute is that, well, you can find two soliton solutions of that kind. So of course, in that case, you will have a remainder term. Let me write it down immediately. And then, well, I'm going to change a little bit the description here, because what is important here is the modulation of this q beta. So we'll have this q beta j, but beta will tend on will depend on time, which is quite nice because I know that this branch is smooth in t. And I can even compute the derivative with respect to beta of that. Of what? Well, again, x minus xj of t divided by, now, 1 minus beta j of t. So this is exactly the u beta which is here, except that I need some phase factor, e to the I gamma j of t. And then I need some other parameter which corresponds to the modulus of here of alpha j, and which I call lambda j, or lambda j to the 1/2 here. So here I just apply the scaling to this. Okay. So I claim that there exist such solutions, at least near, of course, near beta j is equals 1. So in fact, I'm going to introduce some small parameter eta. And this small parameter eta, for each such small parameter, I will find families u eta of that. And the main difference now is, okay, such that, of course, epsilon will be small. So for instance, at infinity, epsilon in H1 will be, well, will go to 0. As t goes, I mean, this is just one-sided, I'm sorry. This is t going to plus infinity. And so what happens now? Let me discuss this a little more in detail. So let me continue this comparison here. So here I choose one of the bubbles to be faster than the other one. Okay? So it's possible to do that. And so let's say that this is a second bubble. So so in the case of Sager equation, of course, if you look at the H1 norm square as t goes to infinity, in the case of on the resonant condition here, and the resonant condition, let me call it R, which is this one, then have something like this. Okay, so it's a t square, it's a parabola. Now, for the half-wave equation, what will happen? It will happen that, so I start from a time, a given time, whatever, it would be zero if you like, but what is interesting here is that you will have some growth of time type t square up to some time where you have some turning point, and the turning point is strongly connected to what I now erased, which is this competition between the two scales, x and 1 over 1 minus beta, and after this turning point you have some saturation phenomena. So here you will have some transient turbulent evolution, and after some time, which depend on my parameter, and we fix the parameter so that essentially this time is 1 over eta. Here you have saturation, which means that the H1 norm is essentially a constant for all time. Okay, so this is the comparative situation. Of course, which means that we don't get a solution which is unbounded in H1, a smooth solution which is unbounded in H1. But we get something which is very excited for every eta. For every eta, we get something such that, for instance, the u initial in H1 is bounded. And the u initial, after some time, t eta, the u of t after some time in t eta will be very big, like something like 1 over eta to some factor, to some power. And in fact, we have even better. We even have HS alpha of S for S between 1 and something like 2/3 essentially. So this is important because for those of you who know this beautiful paper by Coleander, Kiel, Staffiliani, Takao, Katao, and what was done also by people like Annie Posader, Zvetkov, Vichilia on nonlinear Schrodinger, you always get results in the same energy space. So for instance, if you start from something which is bounded or small in H1, you will get growth in H1, but not in HS for S smaller than 1. Here you have some room, because you have a description which is much more precise. Okay. You can compute the solutions just by reading, compute the HS norm just by reading of this guy. So it's time now for me to state the result more precisely. Essentially, this is this one, except that I'm going to now to introduce some quantifiers. So let me quantify more precisely the theorem. And let's say, okay, the date is a little difficult to, well, let's say something like this, okay? To be absolutely honest. hoping this is really the last year. Yes, I hope some saturation also, for sure. So this theorem tells you that, so there exists some universal small, I need to fix small parameters such that for every eta between 0 and eta star, there exists a solution U, solution of the cubic half-wave equation. So focusing cubic half-wave equation on the time interval 1 over eta to the delta infinity. So delta is a small parameter but fixed, and eta is a small parameter, an arbitrary small parameter. So this guy is big, but okay, not that big, okay, say. Such that, okay, so you have this expression I already gave you. So this is this expression. With epsilon goes to 0 as t goes to infinity. And moreover, now I can explain exactly what happens for the two bubbles. So again, the first bubble will be essentially, I mean, quiet. So the beta 1, all the lambda j's, first of all, the lambda j's will be essentially like 1. They move, but not that much. I need them, of course, in my system. But they will not have a complicated and singular behavior. Beta 1, when 1 minus beta 1 will be like eta. OK, so eta, again, is a small parameter. So the fact that beta 1 is close to 1 up to eta means that we are close to the Ziegler regime. OK? But now the nice thing is, of course, the xj's are essentially like beta j of t times t, okay, and so they follow the same kind of behavior like the asymptotic behavior of this, or and they also follow this behavior here, of course, beta t, except that beta depend on t now. And what is really important is 1 minus beta 2. So 1 minus beta 2 of t is something like this. So for t smaller than 1 over eta, I need, in fact, this small parameter also here, delta over eta. This 1 minus beta 2 is really like, is really t square eta. So that, you know, it starts like eta to the 1 plus 2 delta for t initial. But then, after the turning point, so that's really this growth, okay? in the transient turbulent situation. And after this time, you have something like essentially eta cube. And then it's frozen, saturated. Okay. Of course, there are constants here, and these constants depend on the small parameter delta. That's why we need it, okay, in order to close our big system. So, of course, the main idea is here. Of course, the main point is, the main singular dynamics is here. And this corresponds to this growth of Sobolev norms. Yes?
What is your solution is defined only on 1 over eta delta?
Yes. Well, I can define it before, but I cannot describe it for t going to minus infinity. So this means that, I'm sorry. Is that your problem?
Maybe delta is a small parameter, so maybe you should switch.
No, delta is a small but fixed parameter. Look my quantization. There exists a delta, there exists an eta star, such that for every eta,
he means that probably delta over eta is less than 1 over.
No, in general, since I put eta very, very small, this guy is smaller than this one. Yes. Because I can fix, after all, I can fix eta in terms of delta. I can fix, take the quotient, okay? Okay? Now, given delta, if eta is small enough, this is big.
It's eta to the delta.
To the power delta.
Oh, yes. Oh, I'm sorry.
It's not clear.
It's a power delta.
It's not clear.
Yes. Then you agree. Of course, otherwise I understand your question, of course. Eta to the delta, of course. Well, that's the problem with the choke talk. But okay, it has other advantages, I think. Particularly in this situation. All right. So this is the situation, okay? So now, I still have something like 5 minutes or seven or?
Less.
Oh.
You have 2 minutes normally that I can do.
2 minutes? I start in, yes, 2 minutes, okay. I can tell you exactly in 2 minutes what is the detail of this proof, of course. Well, as in many other results, in particular in the very nice pioneering work by Martel and also works by Martel and Mer, and also work with Pierre Raphael, there are several authors of it. I think the first one was in. So there are essentially two parts, which are, so these were for KDV and also for some also for NLS. The first part is construct an approximate solution. So construct an approximate solution, of course you plug this expression that I write again here, but I'm going to write it slightly differently, like this. So e to the I gamma j of t divided by lambda j of t to the 1 half, capital Vj of x minus xj of t divided by lambda j of t, 1 minus beta j of t, and depending on some parameters, which are lambda 1 of t, lambda 2, beta 1, beta 2, and some gamma 2 minus gamma 1, and also x2 minus x1, say. Okay. Okay, so you plug this into the equation, and you extract from that a system of equation on Vj's, on V1 and V2. And this system starts like this, mod d minus beta g d divided by 1 minus beta j plus 1 Vj minus Vj square Vj. So observe that this is the starting point. This is really this equation, except that now I have, of course, a remainder term, which is very big, okay? So you have a very important remainder term, which is a linear combination essentially of objects which are made with qbeta j's, and some remainder terms. But OK, let me write it down like this. And of course, you initialize. So vj will be something like qbeta j plus some remainder terms, tj1, tj2, etc. And in fact, these guys will be really remainder term in the sense that they decay like 1 over r, where r is this parameter. So this is a scale, the scale distance between the two bubbles. So you have these two centers here. You scale it with 1 minus beta 1, which will be eta, finally. And essentially, this is like 1 over r. This is like 1 over r squared. And you make some kind of geometric optics expansion. For doing this expansion, you need to know very well what's the structure of the kernel of the linearized equation here. Because as soon as you put the first term here, you will get the linearized equation. But you know it, precisely. You know it if beta is close to 1, because this kernel, well, you can compute it because you know the case, the limit case, the kernel of LQ plus. So you know that the kernel of this guy is the span of I q beta j and dx q beta j. This is extremely important. So you have a codimension 2 range. So applying Fredholm theory, you are going to solve linearized equation up to introducing two directions which will help you to be orthogonal to the kernel, to the image, since I'm dealing with self-adjoint operators. Okay, so these two directions will be introduced here, and the coefficients of these two directions will be parameters which are extremely important and which you will see in the system on all these parameters. Okay. And in these guys, you have in particular the expression of q beta. So you have something like q beta r, q beta of r, where r is this parameter here, which plays a very important role. Okay. So this is the main thing. And of course, a part which is extremely important in this construction is to study the system here. Now, just 1 minute. OK, I'm already late. The second part is, of course, the energy estimate. So construct an exact solution. Close to the approximate solution to this. So for that, there is some kind of a roadmap, I would say. Another one. So you have your approximate solution here, and you pick a sequence of times which go to plus infinity. And at that time, you solve the equation with u of tn equals u app of tn. Now, what you are going to do is to write u not as u app plus some remainder term, but with some other u app corresponding to other parameters here. So that's why I put a tilde plus a remainder term. Why do I put another one? Well, of course, we expect that it's not that far. But because essentially, I need some orthogonality properties. Properties of this remainder term related to, again, the kernel of my linearized operator. Okay, so these orthogonality properties are extremely important to allow us then to study, to introduce, and then I will be extremely vague, localized energy functional. So this localized energy, what's the difficulty here? In fact, the difficulty is that you have two bubbles and they are strongly interacting. Why are they strongly interacting? Precisely because the profiles, q beta, do not decay exponentially. They decay very, very slowly. Okay? so that even if they are far away from each other, they still interact. Okay, so the point is that the localized energy functional should take care of that. And what you do, in fact, is that you write everything in the frame which is connected to the slowest of these two bubbles. So this is the bubble one here. And you write an energy on this guy. So this localized energy function, unfortunately, is not completely coercive. You lose a little bit of the H half norm for the plus part of this guy. And so you have to really to propagate this by using very precise energy estimate for that. And the rest will be the paper, hopefully before the summer. Thank you very much for your attention.
I have one. Have you tried to construct three or more solitons?
Yes, yes, we tried. I mean, we are trying, in fact. The problem is that we need to respect this the fact that we are close to the resonant situation. So here we assumed, I didn't tell you, but we assume that our parameters, our initial parameters, are close to this resonant manifold, and this is not that easy to manufacture them in more than one. And this is, there is another problem, which is if you look at the three solitons in the Zeiger regime, well, of course you can make them draw like T square, but never more. Okay, so the fact that you add another soliton in the Zeiger regime does not make you grow to infinity faster. So this means that there is some kind of, again, maybe some kind of saturation in this regime too, even by adding some. So we still have the hope to look at more than two solitons and to get something which goes finally to infinity, but we are not sure. Maybe there is something. And there are some computations, some simulations of Pierre, he told me, on some different kind of system, but not that far from this one, where generically you see rather some kind of saturation. So maybe that's the generic phenomenon in that case.
Yes. Does the Zeiger equation play any role in the proof?
Yes. It plays a role because of that. Because of the fact that you know, you need to know the description of the linearized operators. And of course, these linearized operators are close in the terms of Fredholm estimates of the linearized operator for Zeiger. And the linearized operator for Zeiger is completely studied because of the integrability of Zeiger.
Okay. It's a level of estimate.
See, it's a level of estimate. We are a little more free with respect to Zeiger, and in particular, in fact, we need to be, because the phenomenon is different. But it's different after some time. So the first part of the phenomenon is really like Zeiger, but we don't need to use, you're right, the formula, the explicit formula from the integrability of Zeiger, because in fact, we manufactured the system in such a way that it looks like our Zeiger equation. And the Zeiger equation, in this very particular case, you can do it really elementarily. There is this system of Zeiger in that case is really elementary. Once you found the four conservation laws, so now you can say that we were very happy. We found the fourth conservation law, and or you could be more. Honest and say that in fact there are infinitely many conservation laws, and we dared to do that because we knew that it was integrable. Then it's a matter of taste.
More questions?
In fact, I have one. The last one. So you mentioned, so you construct two solitons at infinity.
Yes.
At plus infinity. Now you have a certain range of parameters in your construction. I guess when you have like KdV free regime, when you look for all time.
In fact, we have.
Well, maybe it doesn't really matter. But you have the case where they will never collide.
Yes.
So
when yes, essentially, we are in this situation here. We avoid the colliding of them. Yes. Yeah.
So can you hope to do it for all time?
Okay, so for Seger, we can study collision. Okay, it's completely yes. painless in some sense. Yes. But the problem is to keep the smallness and the smallness of 1 minus beta for all time. So for the moment, we don't know how to do that. But okay, there is some very, it's a very natural hope, of course. What happens to this solution for t going to minus infinity, I don't know for the moment.
Okay. But,
of course. And maybe just...
just one small question after the last question, which is, t squared eta seems to become big in this region.
T squared eta, whatever?
It seems to become big. You have delta over eta squared.
Yes, eta cube divided by delta square. So if t is delta over eta, is eta cube? No, it's not your question. I'm sorry, I didn't say. But you know, delta is a small but fixed parameter. Here I have some constant here depending on delta too.
But then the first one, delta squared divided by eta squared times eta.
No, t squared. Yes, delta squared divided by eta. I'm sorry. You're right. It's eta divided by t squared. Sorry. It's eta divided by t squared. I mixed this and the H1 norm. Sorry. Eta divided by t squared.
Parameters.
Yeah. Yes.
There's a parameter one over
zero. I mean the same error that they do every time. Yes. You know.
Depending the order, either you play with the parameter lambda
or with the norm. Yeah. Okay. Sorry. And thank you for.
Okay.
For
so I suggest to thank the speaker.
Okay, thank you very much.